So I founded Vala 3 years ago. And I'll just tell you a really short bit of the backstory to what led up to the organisation that we have now. I've been in conventional publishing. I was in conventional publishing all of my working life. And I ended up as a commissioning editor in psychology at Blackwell's in Oxford. And I loved my job. But then I got more and more disillusioned with it because basically I was being asked to commission books in order to make Mr. Nigel Blackwell even more rich than he already was. And it felt like the profit motive that overtakes most businesses, well, many publishing businesses at that time, was stopping us deciding on books to publish books that were really needed. And I just got a bit sick of it, and so I left and I went to India, as people do. And then I came back and I tried to work as a chef and as a baker and all sorts of things and was rubbish at it. And so I had to go back to Blackwell's with my tail between my legs, really, saying to my boss, who I'd said, "Oh, it's rubbish what we're doing." I said to him, "Yeah, sorry, I need a job." And he said, "Oh, yeah, OK, you can have a job. You can commission books on the business and management list." And I thought, oh, God, this is, you know, the last interest that I ever had, business and management. But I agreed because I didn't have any money and I needed the money. And through that, through commissioning that list, for a very short time before I was made redundant, one of the most influential things I read in that time was Sarah Parkin in Resurgence talking about sustainable business. And I'd not really heard of sustainable business before. And this, I started commissioning books in that area, but then got made redundant, and so didn't know what I was going to do. So I went and did a master's in responsibility and business practice at Bath University. And we came here for a workshop, which was fabulous. We did a walk in the woods with Stefan, which I will always remember. And all of the time of doing this master's, which was 2 years long, I was asking myself, well, what am I here for, really? And getting terribly angsty about it all, and absolutely convinced that book publishing had nothing to do with what I wanted to be doing. And on the penultimate day of the course, I was thinking, I'd met all of these amazing people who had such good, authentic practices and had so much to share. What could I do to help them? And suddenly there was this moment of, well, you know how to publish books, don't you? Why don't you publish books and help these people to shine through their books, help these ideas to shine? So at that moment, Vala was born. And since then, it's grown. We're a cooperative of 140 people now, of whom 30 to 40 are really actively engaged. We're playing with all sorts of ways of doing community-supported publishing. And we're just about to publish our seventh book. So I think we are helping a great deal of really good ideas to shine and starting some really interesting conversations. And there's something about books for me that are very soulful and wonderful in that, you know, this book that we're celebrating tonight will be around in 500 years' time, and it will be found in some random place and picked up by some random person, and it will have an impact. And so Stories of the Great Turning was our first truly collaborative venture. All of our other books had been, you know, quite standard, single-authored, non-fiction books, very powerful, but we Stories of the Great Turning was the first time that we really experimented with how do you grow a book out of a community, and Peter and Melanie are going to talk about that later on. But one of the great strengths of Vala, I think, is that what we try to do is to involve people who are not normally involved in the book publishing process. So they're not publishing professionals. We try to get them involved with commissioning, designing, editing books. You know, people with really good, strong ideas, who've got strong practices in the world. And that way, we hope that we will be forging books that are useful to people rather than books that just serve the profit motive in many ways. So it's wonderful to be here to celebrate this book and to know that so many stories get to shine through this book, not just one. And you'll hear some of them tonight. We're very proud of it. And I think I'd like... Now, am I going to hand you over to Peter, or shall I hand over to Peter?
Yeah, you can hand over as long as you swap mics.
Oh, we're going to swap mics, and I'm going to hand over to Peter Reason, one of our editors.
Thank you. Thanks,
Right. Just want to say, pay tribute to Sarah and her extraordinary vision and her persistence in keeping this show on the road. Really do. Just read you a bit. When you know where to look, you begin to see an unprecedented phenomenon taking place in this world of ours. Be they teachers in favelas, forest defenders, urban farmers, occupiers of Wall Street, designers of windmills, military resistance, the list goes on. People from all walks of life are coming alive and coming together, impelled to create a just and sustainable society. Well, you all know this down at Schumacher, of course, it's really important. In his book, Blessed Unrest, Paul Hawken presents this as the largest social movement of human history. Estimating the number of grassroots groups and non-governmental organizations for social justice, indigenous rights, and environmental sanity, he arrived at a figure of 2 million and counting in 2007. Each of these groups and the organizations represents a yet vaster number of individuals who, in some way or another, each uniquely in their own fashion, are hearing the call to widen the notions of their self-interest and to act for the sake of life on Earth. In this defining moment, countless choices are being made, habits relinquished, friendships formed, gateways opened to previously unforeseen collaborations and capacities. Now that's the beginning from Joanna Macy's introduction to this book, and just a little bit of the story. I went to have a chat with Sarah about Vala in the very early days, and I said, we had this really interesting visit from Joanna Macy to the University of Bath, and she set out this, she gave us a talk, and she set out five pathways for being involved in the Great Turning. The Great Turning from the current militarized growth society to something that is more sane and humane and ecological. And I said, wouldn't it be nice if we took those five themes, which are very simple, and I'll tell you what they are in a moment, and invited ordinary people who have been engaged in those kinds of practices to write their stories. There's lots of books by the great and the good of the environmental movement. I mean, Satish Kumar just edited a really nice collection with Jonathan Porritt and Vandana Shiva and people like that. And I thought, well, couldn't we have a book with just ordinary folks in it who are doing their bit? And Sarah said, well, that's all right, but it'll have to be beautifully written. So Melanie is going to tell you about that in a moment. So I won't go into how we produce it, but what I would like to just say is something about the content of the book and what we've actually put into it. And as I say, Melanie will say something about how we put it together. So the first of the five guidelines that Joanna suggests, some of you will know this, but it doesn't hurt to go over it again, is come from gratitude. Come from gratitude. We received an inestimable gift, she says, to be alive in this wondrous, self-organizing universe, with senses to perceive it, lungs to breathe it, organs that draw nourishment from it. And some of the contributors to the book were very explicit about their appreciation and the importance of this practice. Emma was one of them. Emma Kidd was one of them. But Helena writes about the wonder of being in this evolving universe. And again, that's something that completely corpsed on who you are. What?
Jane.
Jane. Know her terribly well. Comes of being old. Jane has also followed up in the thing. So those come out, but one of the things that was really significant and important when we came to talk about this together, the other gratitude that everybody was expressing was gratitude for the people who had brought them to the position of where they were. Gratitude to our teachers, gratitude to the sense of privilege of being people who had the possibility, the access to information about the state of the world, the resources, not necessarily the money, but the skills and the time, the teachers, the background that enabled us to participate in this project. So gratitude became really gratitude for those who brought us to the position that we were in. And we were left also with the sense that as we told our stories, and we were really interested in what's the nature of storytelling here, as we told our stories, our gratitude grew and developed. So the actual process of writing and telling our own stories was a deepening process in its own right. Don't be afraid of the dark is the second principle. This is a dark time, says Joanna, filled with suffering as old systems and certainties come apart. Like living cells in a larger body, we feel the trauma of our world. It's natural and even healthy that we do, for it shows we're still vitally linked to the web of life. So don't be afraid of the grief you may feel, nor the anger or fear. These responses arise not for some private pathology, but from the depths of our mutual belonging. And again, some chapters are very specific about facing the pain or destruction of our planet. There is an account of a grief ceremony in Australia that goes very deeply into this, and everybody touches on it. But there was another question which I suspect you will, or another darkness that I suspect many of you will recognise, that was the darkness of who am I to be? Who am I to be, and what am I to do in the face of the challenges of our time? Identity and the way in which we live and act and interact are central themes interwoven with reflections of the unrest, uncertainty, disruption, and the questioning about the very core of who we are as human beings. For some people, these questions were with them since their childhood, and others they had evolved later in life. But what we said is that our society doesn't seem to provide any facility for doing this. So as we step out and start to do odd things because we care about the planet, what do our friends and our neighbours think of us, and how do we respond to those kinds of questions? Dare to vision. We will never bring forth what we haven't dared to dream or learn to imagine. The imagination is the most underdeveloped, even atrophied, of our mental capacities. And never has its juicy, enlivening power been more desperately needed than now. And all of our contributors were driven by an imaginative vision of what might be. All of them had to translate this vision into some kind of practical action. And that's what this book is about. But dreams turned into reality is complex. The imaginative visions work at different levels. Some are immediately practical, while the wider vision lurks in the background, and some are more encompassing. So in the book, there are stories about practical projects. So I'll tell you about the chapters in the book. Annie Davy talks about the transformation of a piece of wasteland into a community garden. Celia Susek writes about moving from a suburban life, a comfortable suburban middle-class life, to self-sufficient farming. Gil Chambers writes about installing water power to create electricity in a valley in Wales. Others start from a sense of personal crisis. So Kirsty writes of the challenge. She's been a Greenpeace activist all her life since she was so high. And now she's a mum with two children. She can't go on chaining herself to shell things. What does she do? How does she find herself in the right, in a new place? Emma is going to talk about her challenges later, but finding that a job within the capitalist world literally made her ill. Where does she go from there? Patrick Andrew, a corporate lawyer, realising that this just isn't satisfying. How's he going to do that? Christine Bone, an administrator at the University of Bath who loves clothes, loves fashion, loves her appearance, and realises that's a major problem. How does she turn herself from a material girl to a sustainable consumer? What does that mean? And what do her friends think of her as she does that, as she starts to dress entirely from charity shops, which I'm sure some of you are doing. Rupesh Shah, from an immigrant community, writes about the challenge of being both part of that community, but also the claustrophobia of that narrowing identity and the need to learn to widen our sense of who we belong to. There are stories about developing community from Nathan and Eva, who write about transition. Jane will tell you more about her work in Global Generation later. June, Boyce Tillman, most extraordinary professor of music at the University of Winchester, plays in Winchester Cathedral, talked about her work in that kind of way, bringing communities together through song and music. And she has taken this book, and in March, is it, I think, next year, there's going to be a ceremony of sustainability in Winchester Cathedral, and she has created a musical event around the theme of these five ways of working towards sustainability. And that should be quite an extraordinary event. She doesn't just do straightforward bits of music. They come from all parts of the cathedral at the same time. Johannes Molis creates an education program for young people. Elizabeth Alberts gets deeply involved in onshore of sea session. I think I'm going on enough with this to give you the sense, I haven't covered everybody, give you a sense of the range of the book. And in the middle, there are a set of what we call artful responses. My friend Chris Seeley came to me when we were talking about the book, and she said, it's all very well, this writing stuff, but there are other ways of responding to these questions other than writing. And so she and a colleague, James, put together, invited people to contribute what we've called artful responses, and Ruth is representing that strand of the book tonight. Okay, so the next theme, the fourth theme, is link arms with others. Whatever you're drawn to do in the Great Turning, says Joanna, don't even think of doing it alone. The hyper-individualism of competitive industrious culture has isolated people from each other, breeding conformity, obedience, and an epidemic of loneliness. Well, this book was a team undertaking. That was part of the point. And again, Melanie's going to say more about this. Just to say, why do we need to link arms with other people? Sometimes we need to do it because we want to work together. We need to share the tasks and skills to get the job done. But more than this, the collaboration and solidity are politically important. They're values in their own right. And linking arms with others also brings a sense of belonging, communion, and playing alongside each other. And the final one of the five principles, and Joanna does this much better than I possibly can, is act your age. And what does she mean by act your age? Now is the time, she says, to clothe ourselves in our true authority. Every particle in every atom of every cell in your body goes back to the primal flaring forth of space and time. In that sense, you are as old as the universe. With an age of about 14 billion years. This current body of yours has been prepared for this moment by Earth for some 4 billion years. You have an absolute right to step forward and act on Earth's behalf. And as I've mentioned earlier, both Helena and Jane, remembered your name that time, Helena and Jane have focused on particularly, and I think Jane will talk about that later. Is this enough? That's the question that comes to my mind. Are stories of the Great Turning a sufficient response to the challenge of our times? Well, no, of course it's not enough. Doesn't diminish their value in the present time. There's a seed in everyone that needs the right conditions to grow. And one of the reasons for planting seeds is to inspire others to plant theirs. And in many sense, that's the book. And another is that if enough of us plant seeds, we will resist those who undermine the urgency with business as usual. Our lords and masters will need to respond. If there's enough people doing things in the world, that's the kind of thing, one of the kinds of things that creates a political response. And maybe it's the only thing that creates a political response is that undersurge of energy. So perhaps by offering this book of stories, we're scattering seeds. Some will fall by the wayside and some on stony ground, but others will take root and produce maybe more story seeds. And so that's what we've done the book for. So thank you for listening. Melanie?
Swap books as well. I practiced with this. I'm sure it didn't go that way up. Oh, well, there we go. Sorry. Is that working? Okay. Yes, hi, I'm Melanie. It's really nice. I haven't been back here for absolutely years, and I know I've left it too long, so it's lovely to be here. I suppose it's, you know, so here I am to tell the story of the book and how it all came together. And it started for me, it was slightly jammy really, because Peter and Sarah had, as they said, already had the idea. And I just had a phone call from Sarah and Peter saying, well, we wondered if you might like to co-edit this book. And my first sort of thought, you know, there's this huge thought bubble going, who, me? And before I'd even finished the thought bubble, I was saying, yes, please, because I just thought it sounded like such an interesting idea. And the more I looked at it, the more I thought it was a very interesting idea. There's a few little words that Peter mentioned earlier that Sarah had said, was that, you know, well, if you did that, it would have to be beautifully written. Great. And that, especially, you know, I teach creative writing at University of Winchester and a couple of other places, and a lot of the things I do are to do with writing. So that little challenge of beautifully written, you know, you've instantly got a feeling of, I ought to be able to get this done. You know, this is something I ought to be able to do. So it did seem like, you know, quite a huge challenge. In fact, it didn't turn out to be quite such a huge challenge as we thought. So how do we do it? What we did was to send out a bit of a call for people who were acting in their everyday lives and to do something about, to respond to the call to live more sustainably. We used Joanna's words and we referred to the talk that she'd done that Peter mentioned at Bath. And we had a super response. We had more than we thought we were going to. And Peter and I got together and looked at them all. And it was a heartwarming experience, actually, to look at them. I don't think there was one that we could have said was absolutely not going to be any good for the book. So we had a big choice. And that was when we started to put together, how's this book going to be? And how are we going to do it? Because I don't know, how many of you have contributed to books and written chapters and things, of course, yeah. There are various different ways of doing that, of putting collections of stories together and books that contain lots of different chapters. And quite a common way is that all of the chapters arrive on the editor's desk and they deal with that and put them together. And that wasn't what we wanted. What we wanted was a book that felt like a whole book, and very much in keeping with Joanna Macy's thoughts about linking arms. And so what we decided to do was to run two workshops. So once we'd picked our chapters and asked the people, yes, please, we would like you to submit a chapter, we got a workshop together at University of Bath. And people came from wide and far to come to that. They made a huge effort to attend, which was brilliant. And Elizabeth, who came from Australia, didn't actually come from Australia. She came on Skype, and it was slightly surreal, especially for me. I don't use that much technology, and we had a screen there with her face on it, talking away to us. And she was very patient because she sat there all day, and it was great to have her there too. Jeff Mead, who wrote Coming Home to Story, came and did a session on storytelling, and that was a huge contribution, because what we looked at was what makes a good story. We were really keen that each story was something that was a story in its own right, as well as being part of the book. And we spent really very interesting and convivial time together there. And we had quite a lot of fun, I think. Very enjoyable meeting one another. But also importantly, we were keen that people were able to disagree. So we did have a pact that we could disagree. We didn't all have to agree with one another. And Peter and I didn't have to agree with one another. Actually, we didn't fall out too much, did we? Probably because of that pact. And that, again, very much in keeping with Joanna's ideas that don't be afraid of the dark. We wanted to go into what was controversial and what was difficult about the projects, not just what was the, oh, hallelujah, you know, look what we've done, and isn't this a great story? It's a success. We were looking for stories where people had had a very difficult time and maybe weren't through that yet. It didn't have to be complete. It didn't have to be finished. It didn't have to be the hero story. That was what we were keen to do. So after that first workshop, things started to take off, and we'd envisaged a community of writers. Sarah talks about Vala as being a venture in community publishing, and we wanted a community of writers, and we wanted it to feel like a community of stories. And that did start to happen because people were grouped into sort of buddy groups, and they went off and did some writing, and they shared writing with each other, and they shared writing with us. And so it was a very collaborative process from the outset. We got together and had another workshop and with our final chapters, and pulled the whole thing together and talked about where the gaps might be and how the stories might fit together. And out of that came the stories that you'll see in the book. What happened next? And the other thing that happened from the fact that people were talking to one another and were from so many different backgrounds and different places was that they organised an awful lot of different launch events, as Peter says. There's one in Winchester in March, and we decided really that it didn't matter if they didn't all happen at once. So we started with the main one at Bristol. And we've since had one in Manchester, this one here, which is great, and one in Winchester coming up. Where's the other one?
London.
At the Global Generation, Skip Garden. Fantastic. And Beach. Fantastic one on Bondi Beach, was it?
Bondi Beach
in Sydney, yeah. So that's been a great experience, that it's just sort of spread its wings and taken off. And in some ways, you know, it sort of is a sort of feeling of, oh, hang on, this is our book. And it's just sort of, it's gone. And that's the whole point about Stories of the Great Turning, because the most important thing is getting the book out there and getting the stories out there. And I've got one of those taxi driver stories from this evening. You know, there's people are always telling taxi driver stories. It's not that funny, but it's interesting. My boyfriend absolutely forbade me to try to walk from Totnes to Staverton because he thought I was going to fall in a swollen river after all the floods, or, you know, if I walked along the roads that probably somebody would come along and knock me over. So I did do what he told me to do, and I got a taxi. And of course the taxi driver said, oh, what are you doing down here? And I said, oh, well, I'm, you know, going to speak with some others at Schumacher. And he asked me about the book. And straight away, the first thing he said to me was, do you know, I think there's an awful lot of people who would like to do something in their everyday lives, because I described it as people who were doing something in their everyday lives. But not many people are brave enough to do it. And I thought, Sarah's had this great idea with colleagues at Vala that they would have a random act of kindness event where you could purchase books at a lower cost, the Stories of the Great Turning, and perhaps leave it somewhere or with somebody as a random act of kindness. And I thought, darn, I wish I'd had a copy that I could have just left in the back of his taxi. Because straight away he could see the value of sharing the stories that were everyday people. And that's very much what we want to do with it. And I've lost my track of the last thing I was going to say. Peter actually said it. That was it. It was about the sowing of the seeds of the story. So that the collaborative process goes beyond just the putting together of a book and beyond the deepening of a story, and the deepening of a story that you can do by talking to other people, because it's not just the story of, oh, I did this. You know, I set up an organic farm, you know, with my husband in Devon. But it's that story that lies beneath the story that was able to come out through the workshops and through talking to one another, where people asked each other questions and said, I bet there's more to it than that. You know, and what happened then? And what happened before that? And yes, there was some pain in that. And some people talked about, you know, the fear of talking about what actually had happened and what had really got in the way of doing things in the first place. And then later had come right, or perhaps it hasn't come right yet. But those were the real stories, and that wouldn't have come out had we not been able to talk to one another in quite the same way. So for me as a storyteller and as a writer, you know, it was yet another lesson in how it's so tempting to work on our own. But to work together made it much richer and a more enabling process, I feel. Have I missed anything from the story of the book, Peter? Probably gone on too long. But the most important part of the evening is that what is going to happen next is that some of the contributors to the book are going to talk, and some of the chapter writers, and that's the real story of the book. And Emma, are you first?
Yeah.
So there you go.
Okay. So this book, this opportunity was a really wonderful chance for me to kind of to have a reflection on my life to date, and many threads kind of have been brought together that many born in this space. So I was a student on the MSc Holistic Science Masters here at Schumacher 5 years ago. And I got the email that had the call to write this chapter nearly 3 years ago now, whilst I was volunteering here for a while. And it's been a chance for me to talk about me and my knickers. I don't know if you've seen random washing lines of knickers hanging up. I feel like I have a bit of a split personality. In my past life, I was a knicker designer. And my present life, I am writer, researcher, educator for a new way of being, a new loving, lively way of being. But I came about this way in a, yeah, it's been a very sort of roundabout journey. Yeah, I had a really quite normal upbringing in the UK, small market town, lovely kind of 2.4 children. I was given the space really to explore whatever I wanted to explore. So I spent a lot of time outdoors. I spent a lot of time doing creative stuff. And rather than my parents kind of moulding me into some kind of constricted form that they wanted me to be, they really, it was a wide open space. And so my love was creativity. It was making, it was doing, it was working with my hands, with fabrics, textiles and colours. So I chose to do to art school instead of doing A-levels. And I fell in love with corsetry and with underwear. I've always loved clothing. I've always hated fashion or the idea that style should be dictated. Like, I feel like I've always kind of wanted to do my own thing, and I've always loved fabrics. So underwear for me felt like kind of a one way of turning this into a career, into a profession that wasn't kind of dictating to other people how they should be or what they should look like. So I chose to do a bachelor's degree in underwear design. And it was the only place in the world, De Montfort University in Leicester, and it was wonderful. They had us making a pair of knickers or a bra every week from scratch. We would have to design it and then cut it and then make it. So it was a perfect landing then into work. So at 21, I was offered my first job, and that was in Hong Kong. For some reason, I felt a lot less scared moving 6,000 miles away to live and work in Hong Kong than I did working in London. And I think that says a little bit for me about how I already felt about my culture, about what was growing around me in terms of capitalism and consumerism. And I wanted to get away. A job in Hong Kong was perfect for this. And it was wonderful. I worked for a European company that were having a massive recruitment drive and brought 20 or 30 young new people over from Europe to design and develop lingerie. And it was fun to start with. I quickly realised that I couldn't be creative anymore. Within that system of capitalism and in consumerism, just churning out more and more products to be put onto the high street, the creativity was lost. I nicknamed it either paint by numbers or the McDonald's of design, because it was really reducing it to its most basic element that looked like the thing they were selling, but there was no integrity, there was no love or no passion, no quality, no concern really actually for anybody on the chain. So be it the actual consumer at the end of it, kind of considering what it was that they might want actually from a product, or whether it was the women that worked in the factories that manufactured the products in China. I worked in product development, so I was lucky enough to have a very wide-ranging experience of all the sections of the process. So I got to work actually in the factories, working with the teams, developing the products, and really kind of seeing how that mass-producing machine actually occurs. And I was surprised. I mean, in Sri Lanka, I was working for a massive factory that produce underwear for a very well-known retailer on the UK high street that I won't mention. And this was one of the good ones. So our product development office was on a mezzanine floor, and it was part of this massive warehouse. And the scale, it was literally like a size of a football pitch, with just rows of machines and fans hanging from the ceiling and no air conditioning. So 35 degrees, let's say. And these men and women, it wasn't just women, they had to repeat the same motion over and over and over again. So to get our cost prices down, for me to get my target price down on one bra, I would have to make the sewing minutes as few as possible. So that would mean we'd have to separate all the jobs, and then we'd have to just get them to repeat them. So they were just doing it over and over and over again. I realised that maybe that's not quite a really life-inspiring, life-nurturing thing to do. Also because the hours were incredibly long. I mean, they'd work much longer hours than I think we might do in factories here. And certainly in China, there was quite often a kind of, not technically bonded, but the employees would have to be there for 6 months at a time. They wouldn't get to go home in that time. They would have to live on site. One of the factories that I worked in China, the employees on the factory floor, they weren't called by their name even. They had a number. So all of this, it enabled me to get a lived experience of the damage that I feel capitalism and conspicuous consumerism does. You know, I don't want women making my underwear to be living in conditions like that. Whilst I was travelling to the factories in China, because it was a period of 5 years, I also got to see the gradual kind of industrialization of China. So the countryside disappearing along the train tracks and suddenly all of these concrete factories kind of popping up all over the place, and whole new villages and towns would open just around, you know, the manufacturing of jeans or the manufacturing of sweaters. And that's what would bring people to that place. And so I saw the countryside being wiped away. I saw people being treated like machines, essentially. I mean, we only had them there because we couldn't find a machine that could do it. And if we did, we would have a machine. And then on actually living sort of on the personal side in Hong Kong, I got to see the other side of consumerism. So just huge billboards everywhere telling me how I should look better, slimmer, make my skin whiter in Hong Kong. The shopping malls would spring up sort of every day somewhere else. So I couldn't not encounter a shopping mall on the way to work. And I gradually started to see that none of this was making anyone very happy. So my friends who were also working in various industries, expats in Hong Kong, not just in design, but they were working all the hours that God sent, and increasingly busy and busy, increasingly more stressed with heavier workloads to meet their targets or meet their sort of profit for that month. And I saw the life diminishing in them as well. And I thought, well, it's not suiting the people making the products. It's not suiting the people buying the products either. And that's not what I came here for. You know, I've just wanted to be creative, to bring beautiful, useful, hopefully helpful things into the world. And I realized that this wasn't doing any of that. As Peter mentioned, I was getting sick through that process as well. I just I think all of the levels of my being were just kind of feeling squashed and having the life squeezed out of them. And whether it was the pollution in Hong Kong, whether it was the stress of work, or whether it was me kind of growing up and witnessing what was actually occurring. Because I was still quite young at the time. I mean, it was 21 to 26 that I was in Hong Kong. So it was a real kind of eye-opener. And I just realised one day that I couldn't do it anymore. And I had to find another way of doing it. And I didn't know what that was. I still don't really quite know. But I just decided to hand my notice in. Everybody thought I was crazy. And I was subscribed to a blog called Ethical Junction. And one day while I was still working out my notice for my job in Hong Kong, popped up an advert for Schumacher College for some short courses. And I realised that I had just booked my flight back to the UK, and I realised that there were two that looked quite attractive to me. One was, can the Earth survive capitalism? And one was designing for sustainability. So it couldn't have been more perfect. And I'd never heard of Schumacher before, but I just thought, right, that's where I need to be. So I got on the plane, came straight down to Schumacher, basically. Oh, and that was a breath of fresh air for me. I suddenly realised that there was a whole community, a whole network of people asking the same questions, holding the same inquiries. And that was really, that led to the birth of my upcycling project, which is Emiliano Underwear. I did those two short courses and I did a master's degree in holistic science. I had my whole worldview and being shaken up and down and kind of managed to find my way back to my feet again and thought, right, I've got all these wonderful new insights. I have this wonderful new community, this inspiration. What can I actually do with it? There was no possibility of me going back into lingerie design. I'm officially ostracized by the whole lingerie industry now. I did try and go back in after I graduated from here to start paying my student loan off, and I approached the most sustainable retailer on the high street. I had my agent phone me up the next day, shouting at me, saying they said that you basically talked your way out of the whole interview because you were too sustainable, that it will get the buyers' backs up internally. So I knew at that point that was it. No, don't even go there. You have to do something yourself. And I was unemployed. I moved back in with my parents, and it was August of 2010. And I thought, well, what am I going to do? I have no money. Not only do I have no money, I have a student loan, and that had to be paid. And I thought, well, I have skills. I have skills and I have experience. And I thought, what can I do with that? I realised that in my bottom drawer, I had a drawer full of unused T-shirts and stretchy tops and things. So I thought, well, what's better for making knickers than stretchy T-shirts? And I thought, well, I don't need money to start. You know, I can start something right here and right now. I can do this my way, not the capitalist way, without exploitation, in a way that actually brings love and life to me and to the person that I end up sharing this process and these products with. So I got my old knicker patterns out. I took my T-shirts from the drawer. I have tons of lace and stuff already in my house, so I just started sewing. But I came at it from a different perspective. Instead of just, right, I want to make money, it's like, no, I want to wear underwear that I want to wear because I love it. So I chose the design that is sort of is favourite for me in terms of my fit and my style, but also keeping bearing other people in mind. I chose a style that would be easy to replicate by women who didn't already have an idea of how to make clothing or underwear or even have very much sewing experience. So I chose a very simple shape that you could make on a domestic machine at home. And so not only have I, so at the beginning I was just making them myself, I developed a blog so that I could use it to communicate about my projects, to kind of relay my interest and ideas about sustainability through the kind of portal of sustainable consumerism. And eventually I started making kits as well. So not only can you take an unwanted t-shirt and construct it into your own knickers at home, I also teach workshops. So I kind of use it as a very subterfuge way of getting women to talk about sustainability. So they come to me and they think that they're going to have a nice workshop learning how to make knickers. And then they suddenly realise, oh, it was wonderful. I had two young girls join one of my workshops in Norwich, and I was sort of trying to hear what they were saying whilst they were sewing. And they said, now I know. Now I realise what goes into this pair of knickers. They were like, how can said retailer sell these for £1 a pair? So they understood. So through allowing people to have a lived experience of what it takes to really to make something, to craft something, the cogs kind of start turning. They start realising that actually, yeah, there's quite a process to it, and that you can't sort of have everything for 50p or whatever, as it's becoming more common. So for me, my story is a process of learning through doing, of listening to myself when it said no, I can't do this, I don't want them to do this, we have to find another way. So it's been very much a learning through doing. I'm not at the end by any means. I mostly teach women how to make it now, but I also teach or lead inquiries on how we see the world in a different way, and how can we can sort of alter our relation with the world so that we can bring more love and life, basically, back to ourselves and to our communities. Soon there's going to be a tutorial going online, because I've partnered with a wonderful project called Spread the Love. So you'll be able to watch a free video of a tutorial learning how to make the knickers and download the patterns. And that's what I'm just kind of trying to disseminate this now. So I send the patterns pro bono to any community that wants them. So if you do have a community that's interested, please let me know. And at the end, if you're interested, I've got some of my patterns with me, so you can trace them out and you can take your own pattern home as well. So I think I'll leave it at that for now.
Are you talking first?
A little bit, yeah. Why do you want to?
No, I was just going to...
Okay, I'll just do it briefly. So I'm Ruth Ben-Tovim, and I run a participatory arts organisation called Encounters, and we're based here in Totnes, and we work regionally and nationally, and we do some work internationally in Israel, Palestine as well. And I'm kind of representing a bit of the book, which is called The Great Turning: Artful Inquiry. Which was a call out to arts practitioners and organisations who are engaging with Joanna Macy's work in a number of different ways. And we were invited to submit an image that reflected a project or a practice or a process behind it. And lots of artists submitted work, and then there was a selection of us were invited to put forward an image to represent a diversity of approaches that artists and creative practitioners who are engaging with Joanna Macy's work that reconnects spiral. And I'm mostly going to show a film that we made of a project which is one of a key strand of work that we do called A Little Patch of Ground, which is really about five projects in one, as you'll see from the film. And 5 years ago, me and a collaborator, Anne-Marie Culhane, as artists, really looked at how can we respond to the situation we're in, how do we as artists respond to climate change, but really how do we work within communities who perhaps have never really thought about these issues,
who are, you know, who are in some of the most deprived communities. How can we start a dialogue and a conversation with people in those communities so that they become change agents within those communities themselves? So we devised this project together, which is a permaculture food growing project and a performance project that people are really exploring their relationships with themselves, with each other, and with the wider natural world. And really at the heart of the project is looking at what's our identity. And on the basis that what Anne-Marie and I were looking at, which is will be common to many of you here, would be that if we can support people to relook at who they are in the world, to change a sense of what their identity is so that they have a broader ecological identity, then from that place, their change, their perspective, their role in the world can come from that place. So it's also an intergenerational project. So, and we've been doing it for the last 5 years. We just did a project in Plymouth in Efford. We're doing another one in Plymouth in Stonehouse, which is one of the third most deprived wards in the country. And really, the community get together over about 20 weeks and they grow a garden together, a performance together. And we use Joanna Macy's cycle to really as a design tool for the whole project. So something that's happening in the garden will be happening in the studio, will be reflected in the performance. So we're going to have a little look at the film that we made, which was from a project that happened here in Dartington on the estate that we twinned with a project in the East End of London, as you'll see. A Little Patch of Ground is a performance and a food growing project combined together. It brings an intergenerational group of people together from across a neighbourhood or a larger region to grow food together, to eat together, and to create a performance about people's relationship with themselves, each other, and the wider natural world.
Over the 3 years that Patch has been running, as the knitting together of those three elements, and particularly the garden element and the creative process element, we're trying to integrate them more and more, and we're using permaculture as a way of kind of making the links between how we want to work in the garden and the principles we want to use in the garden and the principles we want the group to learn around.
I've really valued the eating together and perhaps certainly learning about permaculture.
It's really moved me how the dynamics of the group, how everybody is really enthusiastic.
It's sort of been about the garden, but it's also been a sort of growing thing, how to just get along with people and understand other ways of living.
Little Patch of Ground was born out of a desire to respond creatively to some of the issues around climate change and resource depletion, and to bring together a group of people to explore our interconnectedness and to look at who and how we are in the world at this time and who we might want to be in the world in the future. In 2011, we decided that we were going to run two patch of ground projects in parallel, one in an urban setting in the East End of London and one in a rural setting in Devon, Totnes. So recruitment for this project, getting the mix of people that represents a diverse cross-section of society in one area, is really important.
Coming to the patch of ground taught me a lesson that I can grow my own vegetables. As we sit at the patch of ground, I've grown my own tomatoes, hot peppers and chilies.
It's given me a bit of a sense, a different sense of things I've got to learn from people older than me, things I've got to pass on and, you know, share with children younger than me.
Gorgeous. It was such an amazing experience. It was something that is out of this world. I really enjoyed it. And it's something that also I'm very proud to show with people, the local people, and my children.
Usually, someone or a couple of people from the group would cook for the whole group, which could be up to 20, 25 people, and they would, with a small budget, buy the ingredients, decide what to cook, and then share that food. And that was a really, I think for a lot of people, challenging, but also very rewarding experience. Quite often, they weren't used to cooking for that many people, and it was always beautiful and interesting to see what dishes people came up with and their excitement in sharing.
The two projects run in parallel, and the two groups meet over 20 weeks separately, and at the end of the project we brought the two groups together to see each other's performance and to share their experiences. The meeting of the two groups was incredibly powerful and potent, these two groups travelling to meet each other, and at the heart of this meeting was this deep realization that we are connected, that we're very different, but also we are the same.
When we're talking about connecting with nature, you have to look at the wider picture, you have to look at what we as human beings are doing to the world. And I think suddenly there was a light that went on in my head, because it was like, you can't run away from it, you know, you can't just be sort of small town thinking anymore. We are all involved in this, and we're all damaging the earth, and we've all got to stop, because there's going to be huge repercussions.
As well, it's not just enough for me now that I feel okay about the world, that I feel positive about the world. I also have a certain amount of responsibility to help people who feel bad about the world to maybe look at things a bit differently, and that actually I can't block out people's despair, because maybe I can help them to see things in a different way as well.
I just find it massively rewarding and fascinating to have a group of people that span 8 decades in one room. It's just not a situation that I've come across that many times in my life.
As an artist, Patch of Ground was about responding on many different levels, by bringing in different art forms, by the permaculture, the community building aspect of the work. So it's a multi-dimensional project, but at its heart, it's about a way of people sharing their lives and their experiences with themselves and then with a wider audience.
In that walking forward one by one, it's like presenting our authentic selves without anything else, but just stepping forward and just saying, well, here I am, and realising that the diversity in the group, and yet we're all exactly the same.
These people's journey of change and transformation over 20 weeks is deeply moving, and it's why we will hope to keep doing Patch of Ground for very many years to come.
Anyway, it's great to be here. I'm Jane. I'm from Global Generation, and I'm going to just talk about the project that we write about in the book. It's based in King's Cross. We're an environmental education charity, and we work with young people. And I'll share a little bit about our work, but I think I want to say, you know, it was a great thing to be part of the Vala project, as well as being part of the writing community with all the other contributors. It also enabled us to develop our own little mini writing community within Global Generation. So I wrote this chapter in the book, which is called Cabbages and Cranes. You'll see why later on. But I wrote that with one of my colleagues and then three of the young people we work with who are 15-year-olds. And so I'm going to share some, bring their voices into the room and share some of their bits of writing. And we also, it really developed writing within the organisation. And so our participants who we work with, who are the construction guys who are building that new part of London, and as well as the businesses are moving in, we involved them in little bits of writing, and we also incorporated their words in our chapter. And that's a strain of the work that has continued through. So our work is, we're right based, right by the big train stations there. And I think I'll read you a little bit from the beginning. Global Generation's work, our home, is in an old bus car park in the middle of one of the largest development sites in Europe. More than 1,000 hands have converted a concrete slab into an abundant and portable oasis. The process of creating vegetable gardens in a series of skips began in 2009. The skip garden, as it is known, is a natural extension to our work of reframing cities and who we are in them. We've also created gardens in school grounds and on the roofs of office buildings. And back in 2004, when we were setting up Global Generation, I often had the sense that we were uncovering a map of connectedness. And before we found the skip garden, I actually also, like Sarah, was on the MSc and at Bath. And we came down and we did a deep ecology week with Stefan. And I know actually that week, you know, it was incredibly impacting. But what happened for me is I went back to London and suddenly the pavements became alive with potential. I saw connections everywhere. And it was only a few months after that that we were given the opportunity to develop, to put some skips on this piece of ground in the middle of what is the biggest, it's the biggest development site in Europe. It's the size of 67 football fields. And it's been an ongoing process of making connections. And we've so we involve the young people, as I said, with the, you know, the guys who are making the buildings and those who are coming in and out by day, and really had an opportunity to see that this interest in the great turning. I mean, people are wanting to be invited into the space, and that on the surface it looks like there's all these different sectors, but inside those big organisations, and you know, we work with people like, I don't know, the big train companies, the Eurostar, the Guardian, the construction guys, and people sometimes say, "What? Why are you working with them? Why are you working with the enemy?" But it's something about actually having a chance to open up shared conversations about how could we be in another way. And so, you know, we do a lot of, like, a patch of ground, a lot of practical projects, growing food, eating together. Susie, our chef, is here. And we also open up conversations about what really matters. And this is written, I've just got a little section here that's written by Lillianne, who's a 16-year-old who is one of our generators, who are very much the engine behind the work. And she writes, "All I remember is arriving at the skip garden and being met by a porter cabin full of construction workers. I wasn't impressed. I remember I was so cynical and unmotivated. There we were, set a task to partner up and get to know each other. What could I say? What couldn't I say? It's like we were from two different worlds. Disbelief, this wasn't going to work out. I mean, I didn't need to talk to them, so I guessed I wouldn't. We sat in a big round tent with my Lithuanian partner by my side. I didn't say a word. But it wasn't until the values cards were introduced and we had to explain them to each other. Wow, this guy was deep. I got the chance to look behind the disguises of a construction site and realize that someone like me could talk to someone like him. We were somewhat alike, and it was time to break the barrier. So Global Generation have broken the barrier too. They've merged what you'd think was a dream and made it a reality. And I've learned to believe in the unbelievable and break the barrier. And I think over time, people sometimes say to me, did you have a vision of what was going to happen? And I don't know how to answer that question, because in a sense, I didn't really. I just had a sense of a kind of atmosphere or something that I knew things could grow in, a bit like what healthy soil is like, what a healthy atmosphere is like. And I think, it kind of feels like listening to a whisper in the wind. And we've learned that there's something about creating the right conditions, creating the right soil, and then things will happen. And our project, it wasn't part of the master plan in the development. It was, if you like, an edge land or a gap in the middle of this plan. And gradually, by degrees, the developers have getting the idea and gaining confidence that things can happen in those spaces. And we've built up champions within the different organisations. So one of them is Angela, who works for Argent, who are the big developers. And she wrote this after our practical sessions. We often give little boards and coloured bits of paper to our participants, and they sit dotted around the skip garden in the skips in silence and do something called free-fall writing, which is a great book over there that Vala have produced all about free-fall writing. But anyway, we've taken that practice to heart, and this is what Angela wrote. No one can build a community, but what we can do is provide the right conditions for a community to grow. What I experience in the skip garden is the nurturing of those conditions and connections. What we can do is make links, build trust, get to know each other, and inevitably the rest will happen. Once the right conditions are in place, plants cannot help but grow. We have to trust in the wisdom of a plant, that it knows how to grow, and so do we if the conditions are right. And I feel what I'm doing here is an adventure. It's exciting, and the end result is uncertain, but that's okay. And that kind of spirit has definitely, infused the way we've worked with our young people. And Gabrielle was another 15-year-old contributor to the book, and this is what she wrote. Nature continually changes, grows and develops. I was quite a pessimistic person, and Global Generation has helped me refresh myself and think positively of my surroundings and what I can do to benefit myself and those around me. We're not subscribing to the stories that exist. We're writing our own story and being our own authors and co-authors for the rest of the world. So these small stories, they speak to a much bigger story, and I'm just going to finish with speaking a little bit about that. I was so excited when I came across the call from Peter and Melanie and to read Joanna Macy's fifth, if you like, tenant of Act Your Age, Act with the Authority of Your 14 Billion Years. And I'd been experimenting a little bit with bringing in evolutionary ideas into the work, but during the course of writing this chapter of the book, so that was in 2012, we made it much, much more explicit that we were embedding our very local work within this 14 billion year process. And it was, it just through doing that, discovered it was a narrative that linked our very, very diverse, different people that we were working with. And so I just wrote, these small stories speak to a much bigger story that creates energy and meaning as it is told. The story we usually live with, as Helena Kettleborough describes when she wrote the chapter before ours one, she said, is that you go to school, you get a job, you work, you buy stuff, and you die. But the trouble with that story is that it's not very satisfying. There's no oomph to it, and it's not the whole story either. Awakening to the vastness of who we are is and who we are, what we're a part of is core to Global Generations ethos. And then it goes on. There is a sense of freedom in recognizing that the creative impulse to connect what we feel within ourselves, often in immediate and local contexts such as the skip garden or our camp at Partwood, is the same force that lights up the stars at night. It has always been at work in our universe. An awakening to the 14 billion year process that we're a part of is a fertile place from which to grow a new and positive future. However, for a long time, I was very tentative about introducing evolutionary themes into Global Generations work, and especially because we work with probably, you know, the schools we work with, they have about 50 different languages, many of them from very, as in a patch of groundwork, many traditional Muslim backgrounds. And so I felt like maybe it would be alienating, but this is now, it changed during the course of while we were writing the chapter for this book. And my partner, Rod Sugden, and I, he's a primary school teacher, we ran an 8-day summer school in the skip garden for 12 young people. And during that time, we discovered that something else came into the skip garden. So I'm going to, just to give you a sense of it, of where we're located, and I think in 2 minutes I can convey something of this work, of the universe story. So I'm going to take the risk of showing you a film. But I think I just also want to say, you know, thank you to Vala for that work, because we're not planning on having skip gardens all over the country, but the universe story work is now spreading, and we're doing work. We're mentoring a school in Oxfordshire, which is pretty exciting, because the head teacher, she saw this and she said, I think this is a way that we can support our creative curriculum. And so we mentored and worked with all the teachers. They came up to us, and you know, they live in a beautiful little village in Oxfordshire, but they came up to the busyness of King's Cross and spent a day with us. And then the first 4 days of term, just a couple of months ago, were where they began with, it was only about the whole of the universe story, the 14 billion year timeline. And while we were doing assemblies and running workshops outside, the teachers were running, doing lessons in the class, and then getting the children to generate questions. And out of the questions that were generated, the teachers and the children, they co-created the curriculum for the rest of the year. So that's a very unusual school. It's a regular state school, but they, the head teacher has, they've decided not to go for outstanding because they think it will compromise their creativity. And we're going back there in a couple of weeks. But yeah, so that's where the work's going. And now...
Generation, we teach this story to young people because it expands their awareness of who they are and the world around them. Infused by the latest scientific discoveries, this story provides deep meaning, purpose, and direction to the lives of children and young people. the 2 weeks of Global Generation's Big Bang Summer School, young people worked with construction workers, artists, scientists, urban food growers, and a national newspaper.
Great story to tell because it's something that involves everyone and everything. Hello.
It is inspiring, awakening to the fact that none of us are separate, isolated individuals. We are all made of the same stuff, stardust.
Do you know who I am? Do you know who you are? You are the universe and I am the universe. Together we are all the universe. Listen to me and learn.